Hello and welcome to my talk about our paper Pattern-Based Deployment Models Revisited. My name is Lukas Harznetter and I conducted this research together with my colleagues Uwe Breitenbücher, Michael Faltenthal, Jasmin Gut and Frank Lehmann. So I'm gonna start with a short introduction about me. I'm a research associate at the University of Stuttgart and I got my master's in software engineering in 2018. And now I'm working on a German Research Foundation project called SustainLife, where we are working together with the University of Cologne and try to enhance the sustainability and longevity of research applications which are developed at the University of Cologne in the domain of digital humanities. My research interests are mainly in cloud computing and deployment automation. So what is deployment and configuration automation? So as you can see here, there are many different tools and software available to do that. For example, we have different kinds of web services like Amazon Web Services and the Google Cloud. And we have many different technologies that are deploying and configuring applications. For example, Terraform, Chef, ChuChu, or even Docker containers. So how does this all work? So these deployment automation technologies are using deployment models of an application to automatically deploy and configure this application. And such a deployment model may look like this. For example, we have a web application, which is here depicted on the left side, which is communicating with a backend application, which is handling all the requests, for example, which is the order processor on this side, for example. And the order processor is saving all the orders that are issued from the front end in a database. And as you can see, this deployment model here requires immense expertise to create. You see all the different kinds of configuration elements and all the different components and how they are linked together. This is very difficult to create. Another thing you see here, we have a provider login, because deployment modelers don't only have to have a lot of expertise in modeling different applications because of the different kinds of components they have to use, but also deployment models are locking into providers. For example, in this case, we are explicitly modeling the AWS public cloud here to define that the whole application should be running in AWS. So here we have a provider login. Additionally, we also have a technology login because we explicitly define all the different technologies that we want to use. In this case, for example, we have a MySQL database that should be used to store all the orders of the web shop. Then we thought, okay, how can we simplify such a deployment model? And then we thought of patterns. So you all know patterns are proven concepts and solutions to recurring problems, as they are describing the context and of a problem, so in which they are applicable to, and then they are providing an abstract solution to this problem, and in many cases they are also providing an icon. Patterns are usually domain specific. So we have in this case the cloud computing patterns, enterprise integration patterns, which are describing how applications can be modeled together, and the security patterns, how applications can be created in a secure way. And here on the right side of the slide, we see the public cloud and the relational database pattern as an example. So they are both taken from the cloud computing patterns by Fehling, and they're describing, for example, how data can be stored in a way that the relation between the different data sets are maintained. So how do patterns help in deployment models? For example, considering the example deployment model from before, as you can see, and I already explained, the public cloud component down here. As I said, there is a public cloud pattern defined by Fehling, which describes how different resources can be shared among different customers. Why don't we just replace this concrete public cloud here on the bottom with the public cloud pattern? So We are just inserting the public cloud pattern instead of the component. And then we are going forward with this. So we have a platform as a service on the left side where the order app is running. In this case, we have two different components describing a environment on AWS Beanstalk, and they are configured to scale automatic. But what I do want to model is just, I don't care, I want to have a platform as a service pattern. So we are replacing this component here and say, okay, we just want to use something that conforms to this pattern. Similarly, we do this for the order processor and replace the components with a platform as a service pattern. Going forward, you can see that the order app, so the web frontend, is communicating with the order processor in the backend using a SQS queue. So a queue is just an implementation of the point-to-point channel as it is defined by Hopi. But as you can see here in this case, we only replace the queue with the point-to-point channel, but there are still the message-oriented middleware provider, in this case a simple queuing service by AWS. And there is a corresponding pattern which is defined by Feeling, which is the message-oriented middleware. So we replace this component separately here. Finally, as I already explained, we have a relational database pattern, which is capable of describing the semantics of the MySQL database in an abstract way. Now we have a so-called pattern-based deployment model, which we already introduced in the UCC in 2018. Instead of describing all the technologies and vendors in a deployment model, we are using patterns to describing the semantics. Now we realized we cannot really describe all the behavior of the components. So we have different kinds of components here, but we cannot describe how they behave using patterns. This is why we introduced in this paper the pattern-based deployment and configuration models. And what are pattern-based deployment and configuration models? So starting with the pattern-based deployment model, we are going to annotate it with behavioral patterns. So in this case, for example, we want to express that our order application is expecting some unpredictable workload because we don't know when people are accessing our application and how many people are accessing our application. So we have a varying workload, and we can express that by annotating the unpredictable workload pattern here to this application. Additionally, we want to annotate that the application is stateless to tell our system that it is easy to scale, because stateless components are easier to scale than stateful components. Additionally, we can annotate some more behavioral and describing patterns, for example, like the UI component, that we say, okay, this application contains a user interface, then we know, okay, the order application app is our frontend. Then we do the same thing for our order processor, which is also a stateless application and it expects a varying workload. In contrast to the order app, the order processor is a processing component which does not have any UI, so we are annotating the processing component pattern. Now we can annotate patterns to components, but what about annotating patterns to other patterns? For example, the point-to-point channel. We want to specify properties of the point-to-point channel it should have, like messages should be delivered exactly once, so that there are no duplicates. This is of course something we don't want. So we want to ensure that the messages are delivered exactly once to the order processor. And additionally, because of privacy, we want to have the information obscurity pattern to ensure that the messages are encrypted and saved securely in our queue. Of course, if you want to have the messages securely stored, we also want to have all the orders stored securely. So we also annotate our relational database pattern with the information obscurity pattern. Finally, we have everything encrypted, but not the messages itself. So for example, the relations between the order app and the queue, or the or the processor in the database, they should also be encrypted so that the messages that are sent are also conforming to privacy standards. So we are annotating the secure channel pattern to our relations to indicate that the messages are also encrypted. Now we have this pattern-based deployment model. It only describes the application in an abstract way, so it only defines its semantics. But in this case, we cannot deploy it. So the question is, how to deploy an application that is modeled in the form of a pattern-based deployment model? This is where we came up with an iterative process. What we can do here is we just take everything, model our pattern-based deployment model, and then we introduce so-called PRMs, which are pattern refinement models, and we are choosing different refinement models that can rewrite different set of patterns to concrete technologies. We apply different pattern refinement models in an iterative process until there are no patterns left in the pattern-based deployment model, which we call then a deployment model candidate. This deployment model candidate can then be optionally refined, for example, to insert some passwords. So, how does a pattern refinement model look like? A pattern refinement model has three parts. So, it has a detector, it has different kinds of mappings, and it has a refinement structure. And as you can see, the detector is a graph which contains pattern-based deployment model or parts of a pattern-based deployment model and how they are connected. This pattern refinement model can refine a platform as a service pattern that is provided by a public cloud to an AWS-based platform as a service environment. For example, this PRM is defining how a Java 8 application that is annotated with an unpredicted workload and a stateless component pattern that is hosted on a platform as a service pattern provided by a public cloud can be realized in AWS. But how can we apply this pattern refinement model to our pattern-based deployment and configuration model? As you can see, the detector of our pattern refinement model can be found as a subgraph in the pattern-based deployment model. So we have a Java 8 web application that is hosted on a platform as a service pattern that is provided by a public cloud. So in this case, we can refine these patterns to an environment that is provided by AWS. And this is done by removing the patterns from the pattern-based deployment model and copying the refinement structure into the deployment model. Now we have refined the platform as a service pattern as well as the public cloud pattern within AWS environment. So this pattern refinement model not only refines the platform as a service and the public cloud pattern, but also the unpredictable workload and stateless component pattern that are annotated at a Java 8 application, because the platform as a service environment is defined to scale automatically, which is targeting the unpredictable workload. So we can remove the annotated patterns in the order application. In this case, the UI component pattern does not have an effect on the refinement model, so we don't remove it. Now we are done with the refinement of the order application stack, and now we can refine all the other patterns in our pattern-based refinement model. But something I want to highlight here in this case is the annotated patterns on relations. How can we refine patterns that are annotated on relations? And we do this by also using refinement models, but in this case, the detector looks a little different. We only have an application that should not be changed, which is indicated with the stay mapping, and a relational database pattern. It should also not be changed. But as you can see, we have a SQL connection annotated with a secure channel pattern here, which is refined with a secure SQL connection on this case. So when we apply this pattern refinement model to our pattern-based deployment model, we are just looking at our order processor that is connecting to our relational database. By applying the refinement model, the relation gets refined to a secure SQL connection. So now, if we apply our iterative process, we can refine all the other patterns that are now in our pattern-based deployment model, and we may end up with an application that maybe looks like that, which is executable again, but instead of having to manually create and configure it, the executable model was derived automatically by applying pattern refinement models to the pattern-based deployment model. What do we get by using pattern-based deployment models instead of modeling concrete technologies? So first we only need to understand the basic concepts we want to use. We don't need to have technology-specific knowledge about each and every vendor, each and every technology, how to configure it, and how we can combine them together. And by using pattern-based deployment models, we avoid vendor and technology logins, because we only use the semantics, and we can have different kinds of pattern refinement models, for example for the Google Cloud, for Azure, and as we saw for AWS. So we can easily switch vendors and technologies for different deployments. We implemented everything as an open source implementation, which is available on GitHub, and we also provide a demo video which shows how our implementation works. Lastly, we have a limitation which is based on the assumption that the deployment model is correct, so that the patterns are used correctly. Otherwise, we won't find refinements for the connected patterns, and then we cannot deploy the application. And also, we want to extend the approach by generating different kinds of PRMs, because if you replace a subgraph of a pattern refinement model with one refinement model, then the other refinement model may not be applicable anymore, because we don't find a subgraph in our model, and then we want to generate these permutations where single elements, single patterns are already refined in a detector. So that was all from my side. Thank you for your attention, and please leave your questions in the comments or write me an email. Thank you.